Hi, good morning all of you, and a very warm welcome to you all. I hope you all are healthy and staying safe. I am Imani, and an event coordinator and also a communication manager of Urban Transport News. So as we all know that COVID-19 has affected major infrastructure projects in India and rest of the world. Over dozens of metro and urban railway projects are facing issues. And some have gained pace by combating the challenges. There are many reasons behind it. So, Urban Transport News has introduced this 3 days Wave of Metro Infrastructure 2021 webinar series on this interactive platform to keep the information live. So, today the topic for the discussion is the world of rolling stock, analyzing new trends with global players. So for the discussion discussing this these issues and the possible solutions, we have our honorable experts here. So we have Mr. Rajesh Agrawal, who is former member of Railway Board. We have Mr. Bedi Karishma, who is rolling stock researcher at PPIMTA Indonesia. We have Mr. Rajiv Agrawal, who is director of MMRDA. We have Dr. Tansen Chaudhary, who is CEO of Fluid Controls. We have Mr. Keshav Mishra, who is Vice President of GR Infra Projects. So before we get started, I would like you to inform that if you have any questions during the discussion, please type them into the question box. I'll bring them up during the presentation, and we will also have a short question and answer session at the end. So it would be very helpful if the presenter may present the presentation in the PDF form. Now, without a further ado, we'll turn over to Mr. Rajesh Agrawal, and over to you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Himani. Good
Thank you,
morning,
sir.
everybody. I hope every may take you to the realm of rolling stock and railways. So I'll share my screen. Yes, so that's the world of rolling stock, analyzing new trends with global players. And basically, I'd like to emphasize three important areas that I believe have been in a limbo, kind of, so as to say, in India since 2019. I think typically India has to play a major role in the Asia-Pacific region, for which we have the potential and we have everything in place. This is already established in 2018 and 2019. Typically, the areas that are going to be absolutely critical is manufacturing also to grow the GDP of the country, the methods that we are going to be using, the latest technologies, and to provide mobility, especially in India, which is like a subcontinent. So the trends as above in transforming trains, I'd like to discuss very briefly in this presentation. I'd like to only emphasize four areas that I want to flag over here. Just four areas where we need to, as I said, we have been in a kind of a limbo in India and railways since 2019. This is where we really need to get started before we waste any more time. As you're aware that India got the German coaches more than 20 years ago, and these coaches were never, really put into the main line. In 2018 and 19, we established the potential of trying to go for 100% switchover. So we actually made 100% switchover to these coaches, and it was expected that within 5 years, the entire India will be only with these coaches. What did not happen for the last 20 years was expected to happen within 5 years. In 5 years, we were supposed to have the state-of-the-art coaches with all ambience and amenities. We had introduced various versions of these coaches in Swan, Tejas, Vistadome, Hamsafar, and Coder, and we wanted to move these coaches at not less than 160 kilometers per hour. So this is the first area, the multi-billion-dollar initiative, and this can establish a trend in rolling stock across the world. That's number one. The second important thing that I'd like to emphasize is that back in 2018-19, we established a trainset model so that, you know, the entire subcontinent can be covered with trains. We'd like to have the intercity trains for typically distances of more than 1,000 kilometers or 1,000 kilometers or thereabouts. We wanted then, you know, the passengers from the intercity trains to be able to transfer to regional trains. So the regional trains also could move at 160 kilometers per hour. They will of course have more stoppages. And these regional trains would cover the last 500 kilometers or maybe last 300 kilometers. From the regional trains, they get transferred to the suburban trains, which also need to move at about 100 kilometers per hour. These suburban trains bridge the last 100 kilometers of travel. And finally, they get transferred to the metro. This type of a concept, you know, we needed to introduce in India, because in India, as you're aware, we had services from everywhere to everywhere. Every parliamentarian in this country wants a train from his parliamentary constituency to every other parliamentary constituency. So that is not going to serve the country as far as its requirements are concerned. So we needed this intercity trains. All this was established for 160 kmph, including the Vande Bharat Express, which is still running flawlessly, as you're aware, between Delhi and Varanasi. So that was the second area where perhaps we should have had more than 50 such trains by now. And we could have been, you know, mass producers of this train for the world market, including applications in Southeast Asia, Europe, South America, etc. So this is the second area where we've been in a kind of a limbo, and we need to get our act together and get started. The third area is in the realm of freight. You see, the world over, they had 35-ton axle load more than 100 years ago. India is still stuck at 20 or 22-ton axle load. The world over, they are already moving freight trains at 100 kilometers per hour. We have been stuck for not moving at 100 kilometers per hour for now more than 40 years. So, in the dedicated freight corridor, back in 2019, with 25-ton axle load, we tested the train at 100 kilometers per hour. And we established a potential to even go up to 32.5-ton axle load and make sure that all our trains are able to run at 100 kilometers per hour. Now, these freight corridors, which are going to be linking northern parts of India to the ports in the east and the west, they need to, you know, bridge this distance overnight. Between Delhi and Ajmer, where a freight train would normally take about 24 hours, we were able to, I think, move the train in about 5 hours. So we have to now get into our act of, you know, putting this freight perspective in front and be able to move 25-ton stock at 100 kilometers per hour. The designs are available, everything is available, and it is part of India's environmental policy and to meet our national targets that 45% of the freight market share before 2030 should be returned back to the railways. As of now, you know, it could be anywhere between 20 or 25%, maybe even less. So 45% freight market share we must get before 2030. And in this, we perhaps lost already last 1 or 2 years. We have, of course, also established the potential for smart yards, predictive maintenance. And we can also make these wagons from much lighter materials so that they can take more payloads. We already have the design for a composite wagon, which can be inducted into the railways if the railways so like, or maybe in the private sector. This is the third area that I would like to flag very briefly. And the final area is in the area of production. You know that India can be the largest coach manufacturer anywhere in the world, far ahead of China. Our production units, they have a capacity today of manufacturing more than 12,000 coaches. You see, like for the last 160 years in India, we've always been short of coach production. Our coach production never was able to meet the requirement or meet the demand. But back in 2018 and 2019, we were able to bring about an exponential increase in coach production with Industry 4.0 application. It is a complete paradigm shift. And the MCF factory, the modern coach factory, which is perhaps the most modern factory anywhere in the world, it can even manufacture bullet trains, you know, if it's suitably set up. This factory, from about 500 coaches or less, is now ready to be able to make 5,000 coaches. And there is a multi-billion dollar export market. This is absolutely critical for establishing not only the requirement of India. This has served the huge purpose of, you know, being able to switch over 100% to the LHB coaches, which we were not able to do for the last 20 years. And we can perhaps be global suppliers at very competitive rates. And of course, the industry in India, I must say, this would not have been possible had we not got huge support. I mean, I see in this panel, Mr. Tansen Chaudhary is also here. You know, we got phenomenal proactive support from the industry. And people like him were able to come in front and reach out. You know, Mr. Keshav Mishra is here. So we need to build upon all this. So I just wanted to very briefly flag four areas of national and international concern, where I believe that we have been in a limbo since 2019, for whatever reason. We can't lose any more time. We can't wait for 2024. Let's get started in the areas of 100% LHB within 5 years, 100% India-wide train set network within 5 years, 100 KMPH freight trains on the dedicated freight corridor perhaps by next year, and 12,000 coach production, which should have become a reality in 2020. Did not happen. It's high time we make it happen. So this very briefly I wanted to flag, and of course we welcome, this is an interactive session. I would just like to say that there was a paradigm change in 2018-19 to start, and this has to start trending now. We brought in new materials, we brought in new methods, and we brought in new manufacturing. This was, of course, a lot of it inspired by, you know, things do not happen, things are made to happen, and they were made to happen. But I think at this stage, considering where we are and considering why we have been in a limbo since 2019, I think in the present context, the Indian Railways needs big partnerships. They need very big partnerships and participative. I also would like to emphasize what I've just, you know, discussed with Mr. Keshav Mishra, who is with us in the panel. It has to be participative. There have to be partnerships. It cannot be just contracting and tendering and things like that. We need big partnerships for continuity of exponential growth in materials, in methods, in mobility and money. So this is what I wanted to flag. Thank you very much for having me in this session. Thank you very much, Rail and Metro Infrastructure, and I welcome whatever doubts or any questions that you may have. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Agarwal sir, for giving a very brief but very concise information about the overall development going to be happen in perspective of rolling stock or the similar area. We wish that we can achieve with the large capacity we are having for the manufacturing. So it's better to rather than replace, it will be a replace and rehabilitation of our existing fleet set. It will not give us the comfort as a passenger, but also from the investment point of view, it will be a lucrative for the fund houses, for the manufacturing agencies, as well as the government institutions. Now I would like to invite Mr. Vedic Karishma to put his words, and considering from the rolling stock research point of view, we would like to see a perspective of the Indonesian market as well as the global rolling stock markets in commission.
Well, thank you, Mr. Mishra. And good morning, everybody. Let me share my screen first. Thank you very much for this opportunity to speak in Rail and Metro Infrastructure 2021, hosted by Urban Transport News and Metro Rail Today. Firstly, Let me introduce myself. My name is Ferry Karisma. I am currently working in PT Intel, an Indonesian state-owned enterprise specializing in manufacturing for the start of rolling stock. We are even the first, biggest, and fully integrated rolling stock manufacturing industry in Southeast Asia. I have written articles published in Urban Transport News and others, and also a scientific paper published in South Korea, etc. Most of my publications are about the global rolling stock market, trend analysis, and so on. I was also awarded in Rail Intramobility Business Digital Award at the Young Researchers Tech in 2020. Coming from manufacturing industry, on this occasion, I would like to bring a manufacturing perspective regarding the topic, the world of rolling stock, analyzing new trends with global players. And as the title suggests, we need to take a look which players are defined as a global players. From my perspective, it is evident that those manufacturing industry who have exceeded their national supply and exported their products are indeed global players. From the data that can be accessed freely from OEC.world, as presented here, we can say that China, Germany, and the United States are the top three global rolling stock exporters from 2014 to 2019. As the rolling stock is often presumed as a country movement, this country can also represent a company and vice versa. And the trend is quite shocking. Back in the day, we would say that the Europe is supposed to be the leader in this industry, with a lot of branded rolling stock coming from this EU, from this region, Europe. But in terms of trade value, the trend has been flipping since 2016, putting China as the top players among all others. And the movement is still as vigorous as ever, even more in this time of pandemic. China's rolling stock export has been soaring high in this time in the late 2020 and early 2021, while other countries seem facing a downtrend. And that was the performance of country export trade value. But how is the market trend itself? Well, the rolling stock market is not different from any other industry. We are suffering from the pandemic, and the rolling stock order in terms of number is dropping even significantly. The number of rolling stock plunged in 2020 after it reached its peak in 2019. The SGI Perker, the market researcher from Europe, forecasted that the global rolling stock performance will dive in 2020 before it bounced back and surpass its 2019 performance somewhere around 2020. But the forward performance and the how it will bounce will differ from one region to another. And since the market condition is quite jam-packed, I mean, there are a lot of manufacturing competing with each other. As explained in previous slide, China rolling stock export has soaring high at the beginning of 2021, and the market share distribution will be pretty shocking at the end of 2021. With this rate, if China still doing the same thing and we are still doing the same business as well, probably we will see something different in the end of 2021. Probably we will see a market dominated by one player only. How China wins the market? For obvious reason, China consider its rolling stock market as a country movement. It is supported by a solid industrial pyramid. They have a lot of rolling stock component manufacturing, and they only support one rolling stock manufacturer, which is CRRC. And they do not stop at that. CRRC acquired Foslo locomotive recently. And how the market reacts to that? More merger, for example, like Alstom Bombardier, even Alstom and Siemens starting discussing on merging or something right now, but it is still prohibited. And it is not just in manufacturing, even in business, leasing industry, and even operator see that the merger or acquisition is a efficient way to move differently. And what the future hope? Well, as rolling stock market is often resumed directly as the GDP of the country, we see nice scenarios that will happen depending on how we treat profit and also how we treat our economy. From my data, it is we perhaps see two kind of scenarios. First of all, is the fee take down, and second is you take down, which is it may take longer than the for a condition to go back as normal. But let's hope for the best. And this is just a global overview. It is different from one region to other regions. Thank you. That's all from me. If you have any questions or expecting me to forecast any region in specific market, please drop me an email. I think that's all from me.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Bedi, for putting some very important data point as well as the world perspective about how the rolling stock market and the future is going to be, especially after a large-scale merger and acquisition of major companies who are established from last 100 years. And now they have taken over by some of the giant companies like Alstom or CRRC. So I would like to initiate the discussion on this aspect, considering the Rajesh Agarwal sir view on rolling stock, how overall market is, and Mr. Bedi Krishna's research or data collections about this. So one of the major question I always having in mind that everybody is talking about the speed of rolling stock, that is 100 kmph or 200 kmph or 500 kmph standard. But nobody is talking about the cruising speed, how much average speed we are going to have in the overall journey. As Rajesh Agarwal sir explained, that a Delhi to Ajmer having a 24-hour or 20-hour of freight train, but inducting DFCC, it will be reduced to the 5 or 6 hours. So how important is for the modern rolling stock, who can use, who can be used in the same track, because that's a very challenge. Changing rolling stock is easy, but changing complete infrastructure is very difficult. So how the modern rolling stock can contribute into reaching or the higher the average speed overall from journey, entire journey?
So let me just very briefly say, Mr. Mishra, that the average speed of a train, a mail express train in India, was considered to be about 50 or 55 kilometers per hour. Now, with the coming of our Vande Bharat Express, we could raise the bar to 100 kilometers per hour, the average speed. And that is assuming that the maximum speed will only be limited to 130. You see, Indian Railways more than 50 years ago decided to go for 160 kilometers per hour. So this was made a reality sometime in 1819. We could have gone to 160 kilometers per hour. We tested the Vande Bharat Express at 180 kilometers per hour on the Western Railway and the Northwestern Railway between Mumbai and Delhi. And we could do Bombay-Delhi perhaps in even 12 hours. That could have become a reality in 2019 or 2020. So I think we need to now decide that the average speed of a passenger train should be anywhere between 80 and 100 kilometers per hour. That's what we need to, you know, decide. And secondly, as far as freight train is concerned, with the coming of the box and wagons, when I joined service perhaps around 40 years ago, we had decided that our freight trains will start moving at 100 kilometers per hour. But even after 40 years, that did not happen. Back in 2019, we made that a reality when we upgraded the stock that I mentioned to 100 kilometers per hour. So now we got to decide that the average freight train, the average speed has to be somewhere between 60 and 80 kilometers per hour. And we should be on a dedicated freight corridor, be even to maintain an average of 100 kilometers per hour or somewhere near 90 kilometers per hour. That needs to be decided. If we can do this, then I think Bombay-Delhi we should do in about 12 hours. That is on our Rajdhani Express, you know, because Rajdhani really is not an overnight travel. So that is where perhaps we should be headed. This has been planned for the last 50 years in India. and it came very close to becoming a reality in 2019. But again, as I said, we are in a limbo. We can kickstart the process again.
So one more question, sir, considering the type of rolling stock, whether it's a stainless steel or aluminium. Still, railway haven't inducted any single coach in based off aluminium car body. So any specific technological limitation we are having? Because we know in India, like very high temperature and very cathodic nature of environment, it may create a corrosion. That is a very common understanding and common thoughts.
Yes, sir.
You're absolutely right. You see, as far as the customer requirements are concerned, we have to be ready to manufacture the rolling stock either in aluminium or in stainless steel or in cotton steel.
Yes, sir.
That depends on the customer. The National High Speed Corporation wants entirely aluminium. Maybe some other customer may want stainless steel. The customer may want cotton steel. Cotton steel will, of course, be the cheapest. So depending on the various conditions. But we need to have aluminium within our portfolio. So we had established the TOT in 2019. Our prototype aluminium coach was supposed to have been ready by 2020. And the National High Speed Rail between Delhi and Meerut, I'm hugely disappointed that it's not a Made in India project. This should have been a Made in India project at 160 kmph with aluminium coaches. This is something which we had already taken to a very high level in 2019. Really regrettable that it did not become a reality. But aluminium is something which we should have done in 2019-2020. We should immediately go for it.
May I add something here?
Yeah. Rajiv sir, I want to reach to you also in this regard, because being in metro organization.
Titagarh is supplying aluminium coaches to Pune Metro. That order is for aluminium coaches. And they have a tie-up with an Italian firm for the design. In fact, as far as my reading is concerned, the life cycle of an aluminium coach is about 15 to 18 years. Whereas the life of a stainless steel coach is about 35 years. So it is just half, because oxidization is there in case of aluminium coaches. So the life cycle is only about 50% of stainless steel coaches. But yes, the advantage is that the energy consumption is almost 2/3 of the stainless steel coaches. So one has to balance between the two.
But Rajiv sir, Rajiv Agrawal sir, I would like to put here some information, because when I was in charge for Gurgaon Metro project, we took the aluminium coaches and done a very extensive research on how the overall aluminium coaches running in Europe as well as in China. So that the 50 years life is not exactly. Yes, but considering the corrosion and the environmental condition in India, we may have apprehension on it. But in general, the life is nowadays comparable with the stainless steel. But the major challenge which India is having, that we don't have very specialized welding technology of aluminium coaches or headstock, as well as how the overall car body can be built. Yes, Titagarh has started. It's really a great move towards it. Because see, if you have aluminium coaches, then the design will be very sleek, as well as the traction requirement will be lesser as compared to the stainless steel. So do we have, especially in the metro, because Rajiv sir is taking care right now of the metro project. So still we have a very different type of inventory or different type of coaches, even in the MMRDA projects. They have 14 lines, and not sure whether all the line having a similar type of rolling stock can be interchangeable, can be component be taken from one line to another line. So sir, are we lacking this kind of integration or the interchangeability opportunity?
The basic requirements of the rolling stock remain common for all the lines. Basic requirement means the operating voltage, the gauge, and the basic acceleration values, deceleration values, braking distance, and the traction remain same. But the thing is that for each line, we are inviting an open tender, which is an international competitive bidding. So we do not know who will be the supplier. So the design will always differ from vendor to vendor. So that is the issue.
Sir, even it's a technical specification like electrical and mechanical characteristics or parameter the same, but if their the physical dimension are not same, their lifting point, their setting point are not same, you cannot use like same traction motor from X car to Y car. So that's why my question was, and it was
even if the fixing dimensions for the traction motors are same, it is not interchangeable because it is a complete propulsion system.
Yes.
So propulsion system design takes care of not only traction motor, there is a traction converter, inverter, transformer, traction motor. So the entire chain is designed like that. So it is not interchangeable unless it is from the same supplier.
Sir, so considering rolling stock market in India as 750 kilometer or 50 odd cities are going to have a metro network, and also the existing fleet will have some rehabilitation requirement with the specific years. So how you are looking the overall development of rolling stock market within the India? Because now after consolidation of Alstom and Bombardier, players are very limited.
Yes. See, in fact, the almost 1,000 kilometers of metro lines are in operation in India presently. And 2,000 kilometers are under construction. And another 1,000 kilometers is already approved. So you can say 3,000 kilometers is coming up in next 5 to 6 years. So 1 kilometer approximately means about 10 coaches. So 3,000 kilometers means around 30,000 coaches requirement is there in next 5 to 7 years maybe. So which converts into about 500 to 700 coaches per year. Presently, as we have mentioned, Alstom was there. Alstom has got a facility in Sri City, and Bombardier has got a facility in Savli, Baroda. Now, Bombardier has also been taken over by Alstom, but there are two facilities. Then Titagarh has a facility, and of course, Bharat Earth Movers Limited, BML facility is there at Bangalore. And of course, as Sri Rajesh Agrawal has mentioned, the factory at Raebareli, it can also take up the production of metro coaches. But the present capacity, as I can see, is limited to about 250 trains per year, whereas the requirement is going to be almost double of it, almost 500 trains per year, 500 trains of 6 car each. So there is still a lot of scope for increasing the capacity and for new players. And as far as the maintenance is concerned, as I can see, I went through a lot of articles on Google and other electronic media. Digitization is coming in a big way. It is the key boat driver these days. In fact, the share of digitization in rolling stack has already gone up to 20% if we take into account signaling, telecom, AFC, PSD. And I was reading one report that Cisco has predicted that in next 10 years, almost $30 billion requirement will be there for digitization in different forms in rolling stock industry itself. So that is going to be a key driver, and its share will go on increasing. So we have to look into other, apart from the mechanical and electricals, into the digitization aspect also.
Yeah, it's really great to see the future of rolling stock.
Yeah, Mr. Mishra, I would just like to comment.
Please, sir.
There is a huge requirement. What Mr. Rajiv Agarwal is saying is absolutely correct, you know, and this is the need of the hour for these 50 towns. You have also very rightly flagged this topic. So we need a facility for 1,000 coaches per year immediately. And we have a possibility at MCF where we can manufacture 1,000 metro coaches per year. Currently, I believe that in the present setup, some good partnership needs to be put into position so that we have a win-win situation. And this partnership should be decided so that we can get this 1,000 coaches per year starting maybe end of current year or definitely from next year. Otherwise, you know, we'll be lost till 2024.
Correct, sir. And how you are emphasizing the role of the small OEMs who are not big, who are not visible to in the public domain, but they are putting a very integral role of creating subsystem or system level of items for the rolling stock.
Like, they're vitally important. You see, please understand, you remember in 2019, we had the IRWE exhibition in Gurgaon. Because of Pragati Maidan, we almost had to cancel that exhibition. I said, no, we'll go ahead and have an exhibition in Gurgaon. And instead of, you know, forcing the big players to take up stalls and make a show of it, we called all these OEMs to participate proactively. And you'd be surprised, in the wasteland at Gurgaon, where never a convention was held, we had to increase the space by 4 times. And after increasing the space by 4 times, still we ran short of space, we ran short of stalls. And in a single stall, there used to be 4 OEMs sitting together. So, you know, these OEMs have played a huge role. It's a played an absolutely phenomenal role. They came together when we grew the industry by more than $1 billion year on year. First in 2018, then in 2019. This $1 billion did not come out of thin air. This was local manufacturing. These were these OEMs. And I must give full credit to them. I'm humbled, you know, to talk about them. These guys walked up, they took the initiative, they came along with us. And of course, we just tried to do whatever best we could to facilitate them. They came forward, they made it possible. And as the IRWE showed in 2019, I had then wanted that in 2021, we should have better than the InnoTrans at Berlin. I mean, why should the InnoTrans at Berlin be a bigger affair when the entire market is in the Asia Pacific? When the fastest growing rolling stock market is in the Asia Pacific, and all the big players are in the Asia Pacific.
Absolutely.
So I think these OEMs are going to be vitally important. We should facilitate them. We should help them.
Yeah, absolutely. So it's a great initiative taken by the Indian Railway, and we hope that more participation will be there. So with reference to this OEM, I would like to invite Mr. Tansen Chaudhary also to put his words on how the overall development is going to happen from the fluid control side and how they are going to contribute into the rolling stock development in India as well as some Asian countries.
Many thanks, Keshav. And in fact, my warm regards to Rajesh Agarwal sir, who really helped us in getting the opportunity of vocal for local in MCF, and of course, we've been pioneering this area. And as Mr. Rajiv Agarwal also said, in Pune Metro, there is an aluminum coaches, and we are proud to be the brick piping connector suppliers for the Pune Metro as well. So on the trains, I just thought I'll quickly also share my thoughts in terms of the options and the technological upgradations which we all are talking, and how it would go around, basically. Okay, so I don't have more than 5-6 slides, but would just like to really build on the great discussion of what Keshav will draw. Indeed, I really enjoyed the triangular things what you had around the growth of the rolling stock. Okay, and nothing to add on that, but I think as a OEM and as a small or medium scale enterprise, which is really been flourishing due to the Indian Railways growth indirectly, my thoughts here would be more on the trends and the processes in terms of the expectations of the rolling stock as such. Okay, so formally I am Tansen Chaudhary. I represent Fluid Controls as an organization which is an IRIS certified organization. So what am I really quickly going to glance through is where we stand as Fluid Controls, what are the new trends. Probably since the topic was more on new trends, I thought let me also put my few thoughts around global and local, and where the local is also in line with the global expectations. And what would be those benefits to all of us in the industry in terms of taking this thing forward? So quickly, we are a 1974 started company in terms of the brake piping connectors. When I say connectors, it encompasses the bent tubes, the clean tubes, the hoses, the isolating cocks, the clamps or the clips, whatever we say in terms of the overall system as such. And we do not only design and develop, which has been also certified by the Government of India, Ministry of Defense, Scientific and Industry Research, that we in-house have R&D unit to develop, test and take this forward for the customers. We also offer the site installations also, because at times to increase the speed, we are the expert of our components, and if trained and non-trained manpower comes in picture, then there are issues. But then that's the initiative even Rajesh sir has taken at MCF to increase the productivity and to bring in the expertise of OEMs to the Indian Railways, and we got that first breakthrough at MCF in terms of taking this supply and apply. And of course, the combinedly the reliability of the overall system gets taken care. So, just to put forward as a technical mechanical engineer also, I was looking at where this rolling stock and where the things are really getting talked about. Okay. People are talking about using the big data and artificial intelligence in terms of rolling stock planning, and of course that really plays a connected role of conditioning monitoring. In fact, the 5 points which I have put necessarily talk about only one thing, which is one part and the one system talking to the every part and every system. And as Rajesh sir was also trying to say, that how is it going to help in terms of supplementing the growth. And in terms of the commonality, as Keshav, what you mentioned, across the systems, if one has to talk about, I think we need to have common systems for controlling the design as such. And of course, I being an engineer, I looked at how do we really look at mechatronics in terms of controlling few things, basically. So I'm not going to dwell upon each and every point of like, okay, what is decarbonization all about, like hydrogen fuel cell or battery driven, etc. But I think starting from the training, which is the augmented and virtual reality, AR, VR systems, the overall rolling stock together, and of course the supply of those things across the systems is going to be a new trend which one can really look at that. And if I move to my next slide, which I think I will just talk about two things, which is the IRIS, which is also been really guided by the Indian Railways across the OEM manufacturing, etc. And of course, the MCA was the first plant which went on the certification of that. That really helps get the business management, the project management, or rather even getting to the product lifecycle management processes across the spectrum. So if all of us as a customer, supplier, and of course the integrator are talking on the same platform, believe me, it is the resonance. Not only a good combination, but I must say it is a resonance. So it helps not only look at only India as a possible option of supplies, but Fluid Controls is proud to say that we as a manufacturer are supplying to OEMs in Europe, United States, and of course via India to some of the Australian projects as well. So the standardizing the systems and processes, I think through these IVs, I want to have that point set that it is a not only a global trend, but it is a trend which all of us really need to really take it forward. The RAMS portion, which in IR, EEE, as sir mentioned, was also one of the focus, where to the last point of line replaceable unit or LLRU, for example, where we as a product coming picture wasn't really talked about. And I must share Mr. Rajiv Agarwal sir in Pune Metro with Titagar wagons with their Italian counterpart. Fluid Controls has worked on the brake piping towards the LLRU, and of course the slide which I am sharing are part of them, and we came to the sort of life cycle cost also. Okay, of course the fire load etc. was a part of it, but where we found ourselves is that if the global integrator or global supplier expect you to be there in terms of the expectation, and if we have the everything in terms of the failure mode, preventive mode, or predictable reliability plot diagram, whatever we say, are set. The taking it forward in terms of supply and the horizontal opportunity for those particular product or supplies or OEM really increases. And we really are taking this at Grid Control this forward in terms of anything what we offer to Alstom, Bombardier. In fact, we do work with Wabtec of Favili, GE, etc. So the initiative was taken, of course, with the MCF as the pioneer in this, but it really benefited across all the metros where we are working with the Agra Kanpur, also RRTS, also and Pune, Mumbai Line 3, BML, etc. as well. But so the RAMS concept or the IVs, etc., is standardizing the things and not only looking at the trend as such where one needs to really look at, but I guess it is a need of the hour. Where I am trying to end my sort of learnings across and sort of next steps for the organization as such is that across the manufacturers, if we have a common reliability definitions and the process as such, then the whole conditioning monitoring of the system or rolling stock or wherever they fit in becomes really predictable and really becomes calculative. And that's where me as an organization, really we are proud to be local, and we are vocal for local, where we are global in terms of sharing these connections or the brake piping system. And my, if you see the lower right side, where we are saying is that this has opened the bigger platform for the similar products across. To imagine we are working with the Indian submarines, the nuclear power plants, etc. And of course, the export connections are also there in terms of supply. So the bigger trends have helped us in terms of Make in India and Atmanirbhar Bharat in terms of the expectations and supply as such. So major thing what I wanted to just share was in terms of the trend, yes, it is required, but more than required, if one follows, then the sky is the limit. Basically, and towards it, of course, I want to thank the Indian Railways, personally Rajesh Agarwal sir, who was pioneering driving the MCF things, and we really got benefited out of it. Plus the Mumbai Line 3, Raju sir, we will be also working through BML, and of course Pune Metro also we are there. And of course the rail and metro infrastructure for keeping this foundation and interesting topic in terms of the new trend. And rather, Keshav, you really set the tone for my presentation. So I was, after Rajesh sir's point, I was really worried, where am I going to really land myself? But thank you very much. It was indeed a nice connect of not only the trend and expectation, but of course, it helped me branding myself as well. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Chaudhary. And on a lighter note, if you had supplied in Mumbai Suburban, so your quality is very much tested.
Yes.
So I have left two questions in mind. I'm sorry, but because there is some time limitation with Rajiv Agarwal sir. Now, most of the stock, we are going to have a driverless concept. But still, that is not very much popular in India. We are working on GO3 and GO5 kind of technology. So how the modern rolling stock will complement to the driverless operation, because ultimately metro networks are going to be extended, and also the operation and maintenance cost is going to be higher, so there will be also a cost effective solution as a driverless operation. So Rajiv Agarwal sir, what is your view on it?
Yes, on for all 14 lines of Mumbai, out of 14, one is already operational, and for the balance 13 lines, the rolling stock specification mentions specifically for the GOA4, that is grid of automation. GOA4 is UTO, unattended train operation. So this facility is already coming for all the 13 lines of Mumbai Metro. In fact, for the last two, three tenders issued by DMRC, they are also having unattended train operation, driverless operation. The plan is that in the first phase, we will go, even though this facility is available, we will go with driver operation, and in the second phase we will go unattended train operation with driver, and the third phase would be unattended train operation without driver. That is the planning.
sir, connecting to your answer, then the safety of passenger as well as safety of asset will be very important. So how we are ensuring for the upcoming projects as well as the existing project where GOA3 or GOA4 are going to be?
See, the safety is mostly taken care of by the rolling stock design and the signaling design. For the rolling stock design, there is no problem. Already many safety features are there, and in addition to that, we have got this obstacle detector and derailment avoid system is there. Apart from we are having CVTC, that is communication based train control system, so which means that the train frequency could be as low as 90 seconds. And but to ensure safety of operations, we are going in for the independent safety assessment. We have got ISAs for all the projects, for all the lines. So there is an independent international company who will do the safety assessment of all the signaling and telecom system as ISA. So which will ensure that the safety system is not only designed properly, but is also tested and monitored accordingly.
Thank you, Rajiv Agarwal sir, for giving such a informative news as well as information, because it will not ensure the confidence of user as well as also the third party manufacturer or participants who are going to be part directly or indirectly with metro projects. So one last question with the Rajesh Agarwal sir, how the role of approving authority or a scrutiny authority like RDSO or some similar organizations for the development of rolling stock, modern rolling stock specifically?
It has to be very participative, and I think right now in RDSO, I think this is headed by Mr. Raghu, who's doing a phenomenal job in getting it. Mr. Raghu actually was part of the team which exponentially grew MCF to where it stands today. He was part of the team there. He gained very valuable experience in the actual development of rolling stock to the best international standards. He's been working in RDSO now continuously. I think in a participative way, we can go ahead and build rolling stock, as Mr. Rajiv Agarwal rightly said. Not only the rolling stock will take care of the safety standards, the signaling, etc., will all fall into place. So the stage is set. Now we've got to just, you know, convert it into a reality with getting these approvals in place, getting the specifications. In fact, Mr. Raghu did a very good initiative in setting a national standard. Before his coming, there was no national standard of RDSO for metros in across the country. So with his coming, he established that. I think the stage is set. As I said, we should go in for a 1,000 coach manufacture, and it just cannot be possible just if the government of India decides with the OEMs. And I'd like to just mention, you know, since Mr. Chaudhary is here and he's talked of ramps, as far as global trends are concerned, in India, nobody talked of ramps, ISO 50126. Nobody talked of IRIS, that is the 22163. Nobody knew what it is. There were hardly any companies in India, and the government of India thought it was impossible to go for ramps and IRIS. So they, you know, with the industry participation, now all our factories are IRIS standard. The OEMs are ready to go for IRIS. They have already gone for IRIS. And with him, you know, since he had a German connection, I just said that, okay, look, we have a problem with these couplings. I want you to follow the German example, fit it and forget it. And they are ready to follow that example, you know, just fit it and forget it. Their couplings, etc., whatever. So these are the global trends, RAMs, IRIS, all the stages set. We should now make this a reality.
Thank you, sir, giving a very insight about how the authorities or the government is looking for the development. And RAMS is also, initially it was introduced by the defense services, later on adopted by the metro. And now railways are also going into the similar trend, considering the EN as well as the ISO standard. So I'm really thankful to all the panelists as well as the urban transport team to organize such a great session. And I also looking forward a great synergy between not only from the authority side, but also from the development side in the rolling stock market. More competition, more reliable product, and with ensuring 100% more than 100% safety. So I really wish to thank to all of the participants also. And now over to Himani for further taking it to the next level of system. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mishra. Thank you,
Alwan,
sir.
Thank you,
sir. Thank you, Rajiv. Thank you, Mr. Dhansen Chaudhary. Thank you, Mr. Bedi. And thank you, Mr. Mishra and Himani.
Thank you, sir. And
thank you so much, everyone, for the very insightful presentation. And very, it was very informative. And we'll meet you in the next session.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, everyone. Good day. Take care and stay safe.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Thanks.